Three chairperson.
Catch the wave!
Melinda's Garden Moments help gardeners create and maintain a healthy, beautiful garden with ease, inside or out, and all year long. This is Melinda Myers, inviting you to tune in every weekday morning, right here on WHAV. You'll learn creative ways to grow your own vegetables and herbs while beautifying your landscape. Eco-friendly lawn care, flower garden design basics, unique container gardens, attracting birds and butterflies to the landscape, and much more. Again, please join me weekday mornings for Melinda's Garden Moment for a very environmentally friendly approach to gardening. Remember, only local radio can bring you this feature opportunity, but only WHAV does.
Wave weather!
I'm WHAV meteorologist Gary Best with Wave Weather. Generally clear for the Merrimack Valley through the night and chilly. Low temperatures down between 31 and 34. During the day on Tuesday, mostly sunny skies and back up to 55, increasing high clouds during the afternoon. Becoming cloudy at night, 38 to 42. Chance of rain developing on Wednesday, high temperature in the 50s. This is Gary Best. Your next Wave Weather is coming up in 30 minutes.
WHAV Open Mic.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Tim Coco, and this is the Open Mic Show. Chris Porter, as usual, is in master control. He's producing, and thank you very much to the folks at Haverhill Community Television, HC Media Channel 22, for getting us on as the show began. Thank you very much. All right, this hour of the Open Mic Show is being brought to you by Haverhill Bank. Just one bank. All right. We have an election coming up, and there's going to be one more open mic show before the election. So there's tonight, and there's one more next Monday, Election Eve. So I thought, really, if any of you have thoughts about the election, this is the time to talk to me about it. Do you prefer one candidate over another? Does another candidate for school committee or city council give you the creeps? Is there someone you're really rooting for? I'd like to hear about it tonight. 978-374-1900. Again, 978-374-1900. And you know there's another reason why you should call tonight, because tonight at 8:15 or so is the drawing for the November birthday or anniversary cake from LBD's second generation Italian bakery, 140 South Main Street in Bradford. So if you haven't done this before, it's really simple. Just call in at 978-374-1900. Just call that number. Chris will take down the name of the person you want to wish a happy birthday to or a happy anniversary. And then you come on the air and you say, "Happy birthday, Sam. Happy anniversary, Sam and Mary." And then their name is entered into the hat and we'll draw for 8:15. Now again, November birthdays and anniversaries. So anytime next month someone's having a birthday or an anniversary, check your calendars right now. This is your chance. And they'll be very surprised. And of course, why don't you do what Brian, one of our longtime listeners, did? He made sure he wished his neighbor a happy birthday so he could get a slice of cake. Now, I'm not saying that was his motive, but I would do it. So this is a great time to think about November. All right. So the open mic show is on until 8:30 this evening. WHAV.tv on your computer or smartphone, and on HC Media Channel 22, Comcast in Haverhill. But WHAV is on 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at WHAV.net. WHAV.net, like network. All right, AM radio, 1640 in Northern Haverhill, Plasto, and Atkinson, New Hampshire, if there are any AM radio listeners left. And on cable television, usually WHAV is the sound you hear behind those message boards telling you about upcoming events. So Andover, Channel 8, Haverhill, Channel 99. Now, that's a change. Haverhill, Channel 99. Now, it's on when other educational programming from the school department is not on. So you'll have to check from time to time. But when there's a message board on, chances are the sound is WHAV. In Methuen, Channels 8 and 22 on Comcast, Channel 32 on Verizon Fios. Why don't we have Fios in Haverhill? Maybe you want to talk to me about that. Open lines tonight. Plasto, Channels 17 and 23. Sandown, Channel 17. You know, I haven't heard from Woody lately. Maybe Woody can tell us whether they still interrupt Open Mic and Sandown, where his grandchildren live, for Selectmen. So we haven't said much about his grandchildren lately, so here's a good chance for Woody to make sure we get a message out to them. All right. Again, the number 978-374-1900. If you're shy or would rather not go on the air, you can't win a prize, but you can send me tips or messages at my email, tcoco, T as in Tim, coco, at WHAV.net. You can also use the message board below the TV screen at WHAV.tv. I'll try to monitor those all night so that you can get those in. All right, I mentioned Fios, if you wanted to talk about why we don't have good internet in Haverhill. I've mentioned birthday cakes, so make sure you get your entries in before 8:15 tonight. I started talking about elections, but you know there's something bigger also that we might discuss tonight, and a number of you have already commented on the news stories at WHAV.net. But we had a situation last week. Actually, both Haverhill and Methuen had situations last week that I think successfully tested our safety systems at the schools. Now, in case you haven't heard WHAV news today or read this on the website, here's the most up-to-date information. A Haverhill juvenile accused of carrying what appeared to be an air gun, it's an air gun that looked like a regular pistol, at John Greenleaf Whittier Middle School, Concord Street, Friday, was held without bail because he apparently, I say he, we don't know the gender, he or she apparently already had another probation issue. That's a quote, probation issue. We don't know much about that because it is juvenile court, but we have spent some time talking to the district attorney's office, Jonathan Blodgett's office, and here's what we know. The order from the Lawrence juvenile court judge, we do know it's a male. A male student was arraigned Friday on two counts of carrying a dangerous weapon on school property. Yes, he also had a folding knife. Bail for the charges by Haverhill Police was set at $2,500 cash bail, according to Carrie Kimball Monahan, spokesperson for Essex District Attorney Jonathan Blodgett. That may be the older news before the bail issue came up. Now, in Methuen, two additional students, there was one last week who talked about, quote, shooting up the school, but now two more middle school students in Methuen were arrested for alleged threats against a school building. All right, so let's go back to the first one. Here's what Superintendent Jim Scully had to say Friday. It appears the student had an air gun that had a similar appearance to a handgun and also had a folding knife in his backpack. This is the situation at John Greenleaf Whittier School in Haverhill. Quote, the incident was handled expeditiously and efficiently. That's according to Superintendent of Schools James Scully. Now, the police removed the student from the school, placed him under arrest. The Whittier Middle School resumed normal operation after police reported no further threat to the school, and they had a stay-in-place mode, stay-in-place. So we've heard of all these tragic, horrible situations in schools and colleges across the country. They've come up with a system to, you know, don't let people wander in the hallways, as you might imagine, is not a good idea during a threat, and a stay-in-place mode. Scully explained what this is. The drills and practices that we routinely perform in our school system proved to be of great value, and all responses were appropriate. Everyone was safe during the entire incident that transpired in a matter of moments. Now, Methuen, two male students from the Tenney Middle School. Now, these are students ages 14 and 13, if you can imagine. They were arrested by police Friday in Methuen, charged with making a threat against the school or assembly. And that's according to a statement from Methuen Police Chief Joseph Solomon. Those arrests were the result of an investigation sparked by school staff reporting that a 14-year-old male student, quote, advised that student not to show up for school on Monday because he was going to shoot up the school. That second student, a 13-year-old, stated he would supply weapons to the other student, who apparently was the target of this. Methuen police conducted searches at two different residential locations where the suspects live, but, quote, turned up no further evidence. Now, okay, some of you are my age, older maybe, but, you know, I suppose my generation, sad to say, we probably brought things like cap guns to school and water pistols, and we may have even made ridiculous statements at times, and nothing came of it. We have a little more of a heightened awareness these days with so much gun violence, but I wonder what you think about that. Do you have an opinion? Did you bring a cap gun to school or a water pistol to play with at recess? What would the situation be like today? Do you think the rules make sense? Do you think there should be some changes? Should they be tightened up? We had a couple of comments at WHAV.net about this. One person wrote, this brat, I guess referring to the student at Whittier School, this not to be confused with Whittier Regional Vocational Technical High School. This is the middle school in Haverhill. This person wrote, this brat should never see the inside of another Haverhill school again, period. Another commenter wrote, this was only an air gun, and what about the, quote, previous issue? So this kid is already in the system, it seems. Must be referring to the probation system. So sad that so many kids have no parental guidance and role models. Do you agree with that? With that that writer, the commenter on the site? Do you think it's the parents at fault? I have a little bit of an opinion on this. And I've said this before. When I was growing up, I had a parent that was always at home. And, you know, okay, my generation, that parent was usually the mother. But, you know, it can be either parent today, as long as someone is taking care of the kids, watching them, making sure they're not doing who knows what, who knows where. So society's changed a bit. But now, most families can't afford to have one parent staying at home. Most families seem to need two incomes these days. And isn't maybe that really the larger issue here? That generally we are poorer than we were. We've seen, and these are real numbers. Now, you can ask a Republican, you can ask a Democrat, you can ask a conservative, you can ask a libertarian, you can ask anybody, a liberal. there's no doubt about it. Everyone agrees that family incomes adjusted for inflation have dropped dramatically over the last 30 years. Now, what happened during those 30 years? Things like NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement that sent all of our, most of our manufacturing jobs overseas. So we've lost places like Western Electric that used to pay a really good salary even to someone who's relatively unskilled. So is that the problem, or am I way off base? Call me. Tell me, Tim, you're way off base. 978-374-1900. All right, we're going to go take a brief break. You're going to hear some because election's only a couple weeks away, we've invited all candidates to make statements. You're going to hear some of those during the breaks, and you're also going to hear this hour about this day in Massachusetts history. We'll be back with more of the Open Mic Show and your calls, I hope, in just a second.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
This spot could have been yours. Support WHAV's local approach with your underwriting. Go to WHAV.net and click on advertising to reach thousands of new customers.
Here is City Council candidate Joseph J. Bevilacqua.
Hello, friends. This is Joe Bevilacqua, and I respectfully ask for one of your votes for Haverhill City Council. As you know, I have the experience, education, ability, and vision to get things done for you and your family and our city of Haverhill. Don't forget, Election Day, vote Joe Bevilacqua, Haverhill City Council, and have a great day.
Today is October 26th. On this day in 1919, Edward Brooke III, the only African American to represent Massachusetts in the U.S. Congress, was born. A decorated veteran, he graduated from the Boston University School of Law in 1948 and began practicing in Roxbury. In 1966, after serving as the nation's first African-American state attorney general, Brooke achieved another first. He became the first black person ever elected to the U.S. Senate by popular vote. In his two terms in Congress, he worked for civil rights, fair housing, consumer protection, and arms limitation. When the Watergate scandal broke, he was the first senator to call on President Richard Nixon to resign. In 2000, the state recognized his accomplishments by naming a new Boston courthouse in his honor. For more about this and other Mass Moments, go online to massmoments.org. Brought to you by the Massachusetts Foundation for the Humanities.
Hello, I'm City Council Colin LePage, and I'm proudly sponsoring today's Open Mic Show. Thanks for tuning in. I'm running for re-election and respectfully ask for your vote on November 3rd. In 2010, I was instrumental in launching a single-stream recycling program. In 2013, I worked hard to lower your tax bill and continue to do so. Recently, I found the funds to hire an additional middle school health teacher. These are just a few examples of my dedication and commitment to Haverhill. For more information, click my banner at whav.net. Thank you.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
This hour of the Open Mic Show is being brought to you by Haverhill Bank. Just one bank. All right, if you're just tuning in, let's just go over a couple of things. Tonight is the last night to get in birthday and anniversary cake entries for November. So call 978-374-1900. Wish someone a happy birthday or a couple a happy anniversary that's celebrating in November, and they could win a free 7-inch cake. Your choice of chocolate or vanilla from LBD's second-generation Italian bakery, 140 South Main Street in Haverhill. We're so grateful to LBD's. Besides making just wonderfully delicious breads and pastries and all kinds of goodies, they provide the cake absolutely free of charge to a WHAV Open Mic Show listener. So we're very pleased about that. All right. Another topic, you've heard a couple of candidates already. Another topic we could discuss, election is a week from tomorrow. What do you think about this race? City Council is a little crowded with likely successful candidates. We have Joe Bevilacqua, who is a member of the school committee, now running for City Council. Odds are, this is my opinion, you call me if you disagree, my opinion is he's got a real good shot at taking a seat. Okay, well, there's one available. Council Vice President Bob Scatamaccia is not running for re-election. All right, is that the only change? But no, former Council President Mike Hart is running again. And, well, he's pretty likely to take a seat. So who loses one? And then I've heard from some of you who have called me and left me messages that you've seen a lot of energy out of other candidates like Andrew Vargas, or you've heard more from Colin LePage about some of the things he's been doing, like getting a health teacher in the high school to help deal with this drug epidemic. So you're hearing more than you've ever heard from the candidates. So who loses a seat, or does more than one? Or do the voters like the status quo? I'd want to hear your thoughts. All right, let's go to the phones. You are on the open mic.
Hello, Tim.
Hello, Brian. Or should we call you... You're the lieutenant, right?
I'm the lieutenant.
You're the lieutenant. Okay.
Don't forget, that outranks Corporal.
I know.
He's probably listening.
All right. Well, I hope he is. So what's on your mind tonight, Brian?
Well, you're talking about some interesting things and bringing back memories, too, when talk about the generation ago or so, you know, when kids bringing what looked to be like real guns at the school. I remember one kid in my geography class had a squirt gun, and it looked just like a real gun.
Was he imprisoned?
No, different day. This is just a different time.
See, that's what I was getting at, because I'm pretty sure I had squirt guns or been squirted at on the playground of Moody School.
Every year at a certain time at the high school, kids would bring in squirt guns. I, however, did not use a squirt gun. You know those things in the grocery store, they look like lemons?
Oh, yeah, you mean the fake lemon?
Yeah.
Okay.
They got regurgitated or whatever kind of lemon juice inside it.
You might be right with your first guess.
Well, I took an empty one. I made the hole a little bit bigger and filled it with water. And that was my squirt gun.
Okay, kids, you're getting instructions here. How you can
well,
bring
you
a squirt?
Well, one of my classmates said, he said, I want to see it. I want to see it. And I said, no, I want to see it. And I said, all right. And I took it out, and then one of the teachers walked up and said, I'll take that, thank you.
But you weren't suspended. You weren't in juvenile court. But it also didn't look like a gun, so maybe
it
they could
like a lemon.
Maybe they could get away with that today, too. I don't know.
Well, it's much more powerful than those little squirt guns, you know.
Although this student allegedly not only had an air gun, which, you know, maybe someone can educate me. I'm not exactly sure. Is this like a BB gun or a pellet gun?
Uh-huh.
They can still take an eye out, so it is dangerous to have that, if I've got the device right. And well, he also had a folding knife. And I don't know, maybe we carried them too. I'm trying to think. Did I have a Boy Scout knife? I might have.
Maybe. Or a Swiss Army knife or something?
Yeah, I kind of think I did, but
they
I don't know.
They come in handy sometimes, you know.
Mine had a knife and a fork and spoon. And you know what? I can't be sure, but it's possible I brought that to school to use with my lunchbox. You know, for a while, to the chagrin of my mother, I decided I didn't want to eat school food. And
I see.
And so she would, you know, pack me a lunch. And then after a while, I realized the school food was probably better than that 4-hour-old peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, I remember one time, though, when I was in grade primary at the time, and the teacher, this was at St. James on Harrison Street, she needed to open a box, and she said, "Does anybody have a pocket knife?"
And every hand went up.
I, you know, used a ruler or something. I don't know what she used. She got the box open.
Yeah, you see, it was a different time. Were we just naive, or is the world more dangerous now?
The world is more dangerous now.
And then why is that? Okay, I've given you, if you heard me, I was kind of pointing to economics and the fact that there's usually no parent at home at all.
Right.
Do you think it's that?
Well, folks, you know, between them, they probably had about 3 jobs. And so when I got home from school, there was nobody there, and we used to get into all kinds of trouble.
Oh, all right. So you were one of the troublemakers.
I was. You know, yet I went through 4 years of high school with not a single detention.
Interesting. Well, I wonder, you know, there are other people who say that, well, no, they haven't said it tonight, I'm afraid, but other people have said, no, Tim, you're wrong. It has nothing to do with parents. And maybe, Brian, you're proving that because you didn't have parents at home and you didn't get detention. Some people say it's the violent video games and violent movies.
Well, it's probably multiple causation of many different things. But I'm thinking that, you know, if my parents knew half of what was going on, then, you know, they probably would have locked me up or something, you know, because remember, I was in that generation where we made bombs.
You made bombs?
I didn't physically make them. Somebody else did. I was in charge of...
We're going to have Chris call the police department because we think we're getting a late confession here. No. All right, go on. I'm sorry.
Well, you know, I mean, and the thing is, the bombs, they were just... you know, for kids to use, you know, to have fun with, you know, just like cherry bombs.
Yeah, actually, I do remember the cherry bombs and the firecrackers.
Yeah, we did all that stuff.
Yeah, I guess I did too, come to think of it.
And we made our own, some of them, you know, and so, you know, I would sell them. I made some dough at it.
So you were a weapons manufacturer.
But the thing is, though, we didn't want to blow up a school. You know, we didn't want to hurt anybody. In fact, we actually dismantled some because they were too dangerous.
Wow, dismantling sounds dangerous.
Well, you know those CO2 cartridges?
I do. That's what
put some loose gunpowder in there and a waterproof fuse.
All right, well, maybe we shouldn't give any more details. Maybe we should.
Yeah, we don't wanna. Well, it might be too tame for kids today anyway, but...
Yeah, I know. So it's a. That's another. So we have a couple more theories there. I wonder, you know, if any psychologists or psychiatrists are listening, or maybe just the armchair kind, like you and me right now. But I.
Time magazine called us child gorillas. We were not child gorillas.
Child gorillas. You know, the most I did, and it was still against my parents' rules, is that we lived not too far from the Merrimack River, as most of Haverhill is not too far from the Merrimack River, but I lived in Bradley Brook. And my parents, and my father was very protective of the kids because he had kind of seen it all. He was kind of probably a cut-up when he was in school. And he was afraid that we'd drown in the river or try something stupid like try to swim across or something.
Yeah.
No, what we did was build our own rafts, which was, you know, pretty stupid too. So maybe just kids of any generation do stupid things. I don't know.
Oh, I guess so.
All right. So, you have any more birthdays or anniversaries, or have you used all yours up for November?
That's it. I want to see if Chris wins.
Okay. All right.
Send her a note.
All right. And then we should be caught up now and see what everyone else.
Well, I don't know. My friend from the September birthday still hasn't got hers.
Yeah, I'm. I think we resent something, or.
Or you send it to me, as per my suggestion.
Oh, maybe you did. I'll have to go back and see what we ended up doing finally. I'll admit, now, we did have, I think when David Goswood was on the program, he said his parents had won a cake in a prior month. And this one here, we're not absolutely certain of where the truth is. They either threw away the letter because they thought it was just a solicitation from WHAV, or
I tell my people though to look for it,
or we actually did send a solicitation by mistake instead of a cake letter.
Yep.
So it is possible. But anyway, I'm afraid it's time for news, and Chris is like keeping me on my schedule today.
Okay, then. Before I go, though, there's one important thing. I'm wanting to know if people are going to be offering rides to the polls on Election Day.
Oh, good question. Rides to the polls. I wonder. I'm sure all of the officials are listening, and I'm going to make a note here. Rides to the polls. Let's ask that and see if anyone is doing it. Good question. Thank you, Brian.
All right, Tim.
All right. Now, do you need a ride to the polls?
Probably. I haven't arranged anything yet.
All right, so we have at least one. Thank you, Brian, for bringing that up.
Okay.
All right, have a great night, Brian.
You too. All right. I'll see you.
Take care. Bye. All right, we're going to go to local news with News Director Dana Esmond. You're going to learn more about these gun and violent threat situations in our local schools, Haverhill and Methuen. You'll also hear a little bit more on some other major topics, and we'll be back with more of the Open Mic Show and your calls.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
It's 7:02.
WHAV LP Haverhill. WHAV is a nonprofit community service of Public Media of New England, Incorporated.
Here's what's happening in local news. The Haverhill City Council Tuesday will hear an update from city leaders on a new basic electricity rate pooling or energy aggregation agreement reached with competitive supplier Hampshire Power, Northampton, Mass. Mayor James J. Fiorentini and Energy Manager Orlando Pacheco are expected to address the council and answer questions regarding the Community Choice Power Supply Program Agreement Fiorentini signed October 14 with Hampshire Power. The agreement was publicly announced last Wednesday. The rate offered through Community Choice Power of 9 9/10 cents per kilowatt hour takes effect with the December meter read. The rate compares with National Grid's winter basic supply rate of 13.1 cents through April 2016. The lower rate is locked in for 12 months. WHAV also reported individuals who do not want to participate in the program have the ability to opt out by returning a postcard that will be included with the December electric bills, the mayor's office said. Residential and commercial electric customers in the city are expected to save 30% compared to provider National Grid. Quote, this represents a significant saving to the basic service rate to take effect in November of 13.1 cents per kilowatt hour. It should be noted that the supply portion generally make up two-thirds of the overall electric bill. On a usage of 750 kilowatt hours per month, the rate payer will save approximately $22 per month, Fiorentini said in a letter. Also on Tuesday's agenda, councilors are scheduled to vote on a proposed amendment to a nearly $6.1 million loan order from 2012 for flood control improvements to the Merrimack River flood wall behind Merrimack Street. Under the proposal, the city would bring in engineering company AECOM as construction manager for a new downtown boardwalk extension between the Harbor Place project and Haverhill Bank. The flood wall project included preparations to construct the new portion of the river boardwalk on top of it. The council placed the matter on file during a suspension of the rules October 6. The proposed amendment would also designate AECOM to, quote, review other invoices generated by the Harbor Place project, end quote. The Haverhill City Council meets at 7 p.m. Tuesday in council chambers at Haverhill City Hall. A Haverhill juvenile accused of carrying what appeared to be an air gun at J.G. Whittier Middle School Friday was ordered held without bail for a, quote, probation issue, end quote. The order from a Lawrence juvenile court judge came during the unidentified male student's arraignment Friday on two counts of carrying a dangerous weapon on school property. Bail for the charges by Haverhill Police was set at $2,500 cash bail, according to Kerry Kimball Monahan, spokesperson for Essex District Attorney Jonathan Blodgett. Friday's incident at Whittier Middle School comes in the wake of two additional students arrested in Methuen late last week for alleged threats against a second school building in that community. Quote, it appears the student had an air gun that had a similar appearance to a handgun and also had a folding knife in his backpack, said Haverhill Public Schools Superintendent James F. Scully. Quote, the incident was handled expeditiously and efficiently, end quote. According to a statement Friday, a male student at Whittier School was observed with what was believed to be a handgun. Haverhill Police, in response, removed the student from the building and placed him under arrest. The school resumed normal operation after police reported no further threat to the school following a brief period under a, quote, stay-in-place mode, end quote. Meanwhile, two male students at Tenney Middle School, Methuen, ages 14 and 13, are due to be arraigned in juvenile court Monday after their arrest by Methuen Police Friday. Each was charged with making a threat against a school or assembly, according to a statement from Methuen Police Chief Joseph Solomon. Those arrests were the result of an investigation sparked by Tenney school staff reporting a 14-year-old male student, quote, advised that student not to show up for school on Monday because he was going to, quote, shoot up the school. A second Tenney student, a 13-year-old male, had stated he would supply weapons to the other student. Methuen police conducted searches at two different residential locations where the suspects live, but, quote, turned up no further evidence, end quote. Police, however, do not believe that the juveniles had serious intent or the means to do violence at their school. Quote, Methuen is a progressive community and we take threats of school violence very seriously, Solomon said. Quote, there is simply no such thing as joking about shooting up your school. In this day and age, we have to act out of an abundance of caution, end quote. The Friday arrests in Methuen followed those of two others, including last Monday's arrest of a student accused of making a threat against Methuen High School. Another student was arrested Thursday for allegedly pulling a fire alarm. More details can be found at whav.net. A Salem man was due to appear in Haverhill District Court on motor vehicle charges, including unlicensed driving, after his arrest by police Friday, stemming from a traffic stop at White's Corner. According to Haverhill Police, Daniel Rooney, 61, of Salem, was arrested at 11:39 a.m. Friday at 1 Bridge Street. He was charged with driving with a revoked license and failure to stop or yield. He was also taken into custody on an outstanding warrant, charging him with driving with a revoked license. In local high school sports, girls and boys soccer action highlighting the Haverhill Hillies schedule on Monday afternoon and evening. Boys junior varsity and varsity soccer teams square off against Malden High School on the road at McDonald's Stadium in Malden. The girls teams will host Malden High School at Trinity Stadium. More schedule details can be found at whav.net. Remember, WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free. In the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom, this is Dana Esmail.
Hi, this is City Councilor Bill Masick. As a candidate for re-election on Tuesday, November 3rd, I'd like to take a moment to thank WHAV for all of the community service it provides every day. In a way, it's the same services I try to provide as your city councilor, with my proven experience, leadership, and ability. I want to thank you for your past support and ask for your support again, so that I may continue to be your voice on the Haverhill City Council. Please remember me, I'll never forget you. William J. Masick, number 3 on November 3.
From Feature Story News in Washington, I'm Kevin McAleese. The death toll is climbing after a powerful earthquake shook Afghanistan and Pakistan, along with parts of India, with over 100 people now reported dead. The magnitude 7.5 quake was centred in northeastern Afghanistan. Sudarshan Rajavan, an Afghanistan bureau chief for the Washington Post, said the earthquake triggered a deadly stampede at an Afghan school.
The earthquake struck. Scores of schoolgirls basically running out of shaking buildings at their school, and 12 of them essentially got trampled over by the rush to leave the buildings. That's where the biggest sort of single casualties we've seen so far has happened, but extremely tragic. They were all pretty young schoolgirls.
Britain's Foreign Office has confirmed that five UK citizens were killed after a whale-watching boat sank off the West Canadian coast. 21 out of the 27 on board were rescued. One person is still missing. Our UK correspondent Natalie Powell reports.
Authorities are trying to establish what caused the boat, the Leviathan 2, to sink, where the conditions were reportedly clear and sunny at the time. The UK Foreign Secretary confirmed that five British nationals were killed in the incident after their boat sank during a whale-watching expedition. Consular staff in British Columbia are supporting family members of the deceased as they await further information from the Canadian authorities. The incident took place off the coast of the town of Tofino in the west of the country. The mayor of the town said he was saddened by the news but commended the rescue efforts. 21 people were pulled to safety by search and rescue operations. Natalie Powell, London.
The World Health Organization has ruled that processed meat can cause cancer. The UN health body says eating products like bacon, sausages and ham increases the chance of developing cancer. Nick Harper reports from the UN headquarters in New York.
Processed meats of one kind or another may be a significant part of some people's diets. But the UN's World Health Organization has now said that less than two slices of bacon a day can increase the likelihood of colorectal cancer by 18%. It's also classifying red meats as, it says, probably carcinogenic. Nick Harper, New York.
According to preliminary results, Jimmy Morales, a comedian-turned-politician, may become Guatemala's next president. Election officials say Morales won over 69% of the vote, with results from more than 93% of polling stations counted. The elections were being held after the country's former leader, Otto Perez Molina, resigned before being detained while awaiting trial over corruption charges. From bureaus worldwide, this is FSN.
Wave weather.
I'm WHAV meteorologist Gary Best with Wave Weather. Generally clear for the Merrimack Valley through the night and chilly. Low temperatures down between 31 and 34. During the day on Tuesday, mostly sunny skies and back up to 55, increasing high clouds during the afternoon. Becoming cloudy at night, 38 to 42. Chance of rain developing on Wednesday, high temperature in the 50s. This is Gary Best. Your next Wave Weather is coming up in 30 minutes.
Your membership enables WHAV to remain local and independent. Consider joining at WHAV.net.
This is listener-supported community radio. WHAV LP, the Merrimack Valley's Pacifica affiliate.
WHAV.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
Welcome back to the Open Mic Show. I'm Tim Coco, your host. Chris Porter, the man with five radio jobs, all of them unpaid, is in master control. It's so good to have volunteers. Thank you, Chris. We really mean that. And you know, Chris didn't even cost us pizza this week. He ate before coming. I mean, I don't understand these kids. But anyway, so that's what we're doing. No pizza in the studio tonight. All right. A couple of things. We have received some comments on the message board. And some of you, if you're at WHAV.TV, will recognize the former producer, the great Nathan Webster. Nathan E. Webster, if I remember, the third, was commenting on our message board. And we were talking about the school issues with guns and knives, whether it's an air gun or not. And he wrote, "My thoughts on this school violence thing, do things like my parents did. Take out the belt." and hit them, those little buggers will run, he says. All right, that's one. And Nate also is still reminding you that we have 1 hour left for November birthdays and anniversaries. Even if it's your own, wish yourself a happy birthday or a happy anniversary. And if your birthday or anniversary is in November, and you could be entered to win a free LBD second generation Italian bakery 7-inch cake, choice of vanilla or chocolate. And Nate wrote, cake. Wish I was having a birthday and yummy macaroons. Yes, you can also buy things like that at LBD separate from your free cake, so don't forget them. 140 South Main Street, open every morning at 6 a.m., the middle of the night, if you ask me, 6 a.m. All right. Before we go to Community Spotlight, Brian, during the last half hour, asked this question, and it's a good one. Are any candidates offering rides to the polls? Brian needs one, and I bet some of you also listening need a ride to the poll. And many candidates used to do this. So if you're a candidate or you're working for a candidate, call the show. Let us know if you will be providing rides to the polls for those who otherwise wouldn't be able to vote. So this is very important. So call the show, 978-374-1900. All right. We're going to take a brief break. When we come back, we're going to talk about whether bacon is cancerous and what WHAV is doing for Halloween. We'll be right back.
Open mic!
Tim Coco and the open mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
The Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom turns out local programs every day and night. Tune in for local news, Community Spotlight, and the Open Mic Show. WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free. A profile of Haverhill School Committeeman Sean Toohey. Sean Toohey's been proud to represent the voices of Haverhill taxpayers for 12 years on the Haverhill School Committee. As a taxpayer with two children in public schools, Sean Toohey knows firsthand that children must have the right teachers and the best learning tools. He's achieved these goals even while keeping an eye on spending. Sean Toohey will never stop fighting for responsibility and accountability. He's fourth on the school committee ballot November 3rd.
City Councilor Mary Ellen Daly O'Brien.
As a mother of four daughters, a trustee at Northern Essex Community College, and a nurse for more than 30 years, I know the importance of setting priorities. I have brought this unique perspective to the Haverhill City Council for the past 14 years. Over the next 2 years, these priorities must include improved drug education, making downtown revitalization a reality, and easing the burden on taxpayers. I'm City Councilor Mary Ellen Daly O'Brien, asking you to make it your priority to vote Tuesday, November 3rd.
Community Spotlight.
The Haverhill Council on Aging is hosting its annual craft fair Saturday, November 14th at the Citizens Center, 10 Welcome Street, from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. There is no cost for the table space, and the fair is open to all crafters 60 and over. All items must be handmade, and no flea market tables are permitted. For more information, contact Kathy Bresnahan or Rita LaBella at 978-374-2390. Someone you know is on WHAV. To submit or read your own nonprofit announcements, click on the contact tab at whav.net or email news at whav.net. In the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom, this is Maddie Karen.
WHAV Open Mic.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
Just under 1 hour to win a November birthday or anniversary cake from LBD's second generation Italian bakery in Bradford. So call 978-374-1900 if you want to wish someone a happy birthday, including yourself, or a couple a happy anniversary, including yourself, and you could win the free 7-inch cake, choice of vanilla or chocolate. It's real easy. Once you win, or the recipient wins, whichever name you give us, we will then send out a letter. That letter will tell you to call LBD's. You call, you order your fresh baked cake, you pick your flavors, and then you go down there with the letter and get it. Nothing could be easier than that. All right. Speaking of food, though, I don't know if you just heard the national news after our local news here, but I've been actually hearing this all day. The World Health Organization has come out and said, you know, processed meats may very likely increase your chances of cancer by something like 18 to 20% processed meat. So what does that mean? Hams, bacon. And then they said it's possible that just red meat alone could increase your chances of cancer. Kind of reminds me of an old, I think, a Joe Jackson song, "Everything Gives You Cancer." But are any of you going to change your eating habits? I have been toying with the idea for some time, actually, of seeing what vegetarian life is like. No secret, I put something on my waist here, and I need to work that off. And maybe vegetarian life would be healthier for me anyway. So we've got several calls coming in now. We'll maybe hear your thoughts on that. What do you think? Maybe we should go back to a more agrarian lifestyle. I suppose even then that would have included farm animals. So I don't know. And there are some people who give up meat just for moral reasons. They just can't imagine hurting an animal. So maybe you have a thought on that. 978-374-1900. I think Chris is about to tell me something. Do I have a call? All right. So you are on the Open Mic Show. Are you there, caller?
I'm there. Hi.
Oh, hi there. How are you?
Fine. I have a birthday here.
Well, we've been waiting for you. Okay. Good. This is a longtime listener, Marcel.
Okay. Yeah, the birthday is for Mike Ingram.
Oh, is it the Veteran Services Officer?
Exactly right.
Oh, wow. So, wasn't that nice? So, you're wishing Mike Ingram a happy birthday. He's a Veteran Services Officer in the city of Haverhill. Do you know when his birthday is?
Yes, the 13th.
November 13th. Well, isn't that special? How do you keep track of all of these birthdays?
It isn't easy, believe me.
What's that?
It's not easy.
Oh, my goodness. So, you know, what you need to do, friends, is to send a Thanksgiving card to Marcel, and then you'll get in her little black book for entry into these birthday and anniversary cake contests. Well, isn't that really sweet? Yeah, Mike's a great guy. I have never, ever heard anything negative about Mike. And, you know, when you work for the city, usually there's some kind of complaint, and he just really transcends that. So that's great.
Yeah, I was hoping he could get it. He would really enjoy that.
Oh, that'd be nice. He helps so many others. You know, maybe that would be a nice thing.
I had a question. Maybe you or somebody out there can answer. I guess I'm not up in all the news. And I saw in Sunday's paper that the city is going to negotiate with an electric group for us to get lower rates.
Yes, I can. WHAV has also covered this rather extensively since last June. What is it that you'd like to know?
Well, the way I interpreted it was is that I have to have it. I can't keep what I have.
All right, so how that works is if you're on the default program, in other words, you never ever chose an electric supplier, and you're on the default program with National Grid, then you will switch to this new program that the city has negotiated. But what the city basically did is said, you know, we're going to buy in bulk. We're going to buy electricity on behalf of whatever number of households there are, 15, 20,000 homes. We're going to buy electricity for all of them and the businesses. And as a result of our bringing you all of this business, electric companies, can you give us a better rate? And a company called Hampshire Power has, in fact, given the city a better electric rate. There's a few disclaimers on this. Now, if you already have another supplier, like you picked your own, you won't be affected, I don't believe. You will stay with the company you already chose, and then you might have to switch to the city's plan if you wanted to. Now, what program are you on, a special program?
I don't think so. I've always had National Grid, and when I get these calls, I tell them I'm not interested.
Well, in this case, the city's electric program becomes the default program, so you'll automatically be enrolled. Now, here's the disclaimer. Your electric bill is in at least two parts. One is the distribution of electricity. That's running it on the wires and the transformers and so on. National Grid is really technically only in that business. They simply distribute power. Unlike just a few years ago when they also generated power, they sold off all their generation capacity. They're not in that business anymore, which I think really hurt the consumer because now they have no reason to try to work on rates. So what they simply do is they go out and buy electricity and pass it along to you at their cost, which might be high or low because why do they care? They're not paying for it. So electricity rates have been rather high for supply. So the city has gotten an improvement in that rate, which for the average person, and I don't know what the average person is, you know, that wasn't explained. Maybe tomorrow at
it
city.
It said 750 kilowatts in the article.
Yes, and that's the number that the mayor's going to bring to the city council tomorrow night. And that would be about $22 in savings a month. Now, if your bill, and I don't know why my bill is so high. I think I turn off all the lights. I don't know if our heating system just uses more motors and things to move the water around. I don't know, but our bill is substantially higher. So that's really just going to be a slight dent in our bill. So that's not much of a savings for me. But I do know people who somehow have managed to get their electric bills down below $50 a month. I don't know if they live with one bulb on or what, but I do know people who have managed to do that. So maybe this will be a savings to them. But
so if I don't want to be automatically enrolled, because this isn't going to be any savings to me, my electric bill is very low. I don't have the electrical appliances that would make it high. My oil bill is the one that's big.
Oh, okay. Well, you can opt out. Yes, you can. You can opt out. If you go to whav.net and read our story today, you should get more information on that, or read the stories we ran last week when this was first announced, and I think you'll get all the information. But you can also watch the city council meeting on this, if you're on Channel 22, or this same channel, and I'm sure city councils are going to be asking the mayor many of those same questions. What I found interesting about this, if you read the agreement the city has with the state, the city first had to get permission from the state to do this, from the State Department of Public Utilities. And in that agreement, it says the mayor with the input of the city council. Now, as far as I know, there's been no input from the council. Tomorrow night, they're going to receive a completely signed agreement. So I don't know where the input part came in. But the requirement is that the mayor get the input of the city council. Now, why would the city council object if it's a lower rate? But maybe, you know, we have some pretty smart councilors out there who go line by line through things, and they may see some things that alarm them and will offer their input after the fact. Now,
usually, don't they offer like a low rate to get you to join them, and then they change it afterwards?
Well, I don't have the story in front of me myself, but at WHAV.net, I believe it's guaranteed for a year anyway.
Then you'll see the increase.
Well, I think the city will keep negotiating, and that was the reason why the purchasing agent Haverhill has, who was hired a year ago, Orlando Porchico, was hired, is because he had previously for the town of Lancaster, or if you were in Pennsylvania, it would be Lancaster. he has done apparently some remarkable work in getting lower rates for that town and for Haverhill, and I believe the former mayor of Lowell was involved, or maybe it was the Lowell city manager. I don't remember which off the top of my head. Apparently, had also done quite a good deal for the city of Lowell. So this seems like it's an okay deal. Whether it could have been improved upon, whether the city council should have had more input beforehand, I guess that's what we'll hear tomorrow night.
When the electricity goes out, a power outage, who is going to be fixing that?
That's definitely National Grid.
Oh, it still will be?
Yeah, National Grid is still responsible for the distribution. That's why your bill won't go down as much as some people might think, because the distribution side of your bill, you know, it's like they carried it to you on wagons or something, but the distribution side of your bill will not be affected. So neither will those services. So if a tree takes the wires off your house, it's still National Grid. If you know, three houses on your street are out and you want to call National Grid, you still National Grid will respond. Transformers on fire on a pole, it'll be National Grid. All the city has done is done a purchasing agreement with another company that's going to send its electricity over the wires. It's, you know, kind of a mathematical calculation.
See, then these people that already signed up with these companies that have been calling for the past several months, they're stuck with what they got. They can't enter into this. Is that true?
I believe you're right. I believe that if they already have an agreement and they're locked in, you know, maybe not. Some might be expiring. Some might only be a couple of months. Or some might have an escape clause. Maybe they're okay. I frankly have been very suspicious of all of this deregulation of electricity, because when our state allowed all of these mergers, and you've probably heard me rant about this before, on the gas side, we went from Essex Gas to Boston Gas to Chris is trying to tell me something, and I can never do two things at once. What is it, Chris? Okay, I don't have no light. All right, so anyway, I have another call, but I'm not getting the light. So anyway, so Essex to Boston to, Keyspan,
yeah,
to National Grid. And then on the electric side, Massachusetts Electric, also National Grid. And so we were told through all of these mergers, your rates are going to go down. We're going to have efficiencies. We're going to get rid of all the extra vice presidents that we don't need. We're going to get rid of all the extra trucks we don't need because we can use the same ones for many different areas. But have our rates gone down? No. Now, they're going to argue that, well, they would have been higher if it weren't for this. Well, I'm not buying it. I think electricity deregulation was frankly a fraud and a sham, and I think the commissioners of the Department of Public Utilities should have been indicted for dereliction of their duty. I mean, you see these, now you got me going, these DPU commissioners, what really bothers me about them is that they get this big state job, where they regulate these things. But meanwhile, they're out sending their business cards out to National Grid and Columbia Gas, and they're trying to get a job in the private sector. Now, if you're trying to get a job, don't you think you're going to be nice to those people and give them what they want, the higher rates, allow all these tariffs? And the state has done a very poor job of preventing them. Technically, there's a one-year waiting period. But I know personally of a case where a member of the staff of the state switched to a different job in the state to get out of that one-year arrangement. And then as soon as that 1 year was up, was hired by Boston Gas. So I think it's a big sham. I think there should have been an investigation, and I think some former members of the Department of Public Utilities should be in jail for absolute corruption. So you didn't ask me that, but that's my thought.
Well, it's something to look into.
Oh, I've seen it firsthand, and the state has too, but somehow certain things happen that people can get away with here.
Well, that's always the way in politics, I think.
No, I mean, it's really, I have to say, we have a great state, but it's amazing how much corruption there can still be. Look at our former speakers of the House, if you need an example. Chris is telling me I have to move on, so...
Well, thank you for your explanation. I'm going to have to find out about this opting out.
All right, thank you very much, Marcel, and good idea. Happy birthday to Mike Ingram.
Okie doke. Bye-bye.
Take care. All right. I know we've got calls backed up. If you could bear with me 1 minute, I am getting behind. We're going to go to local weather. We'll be back with more of the Open Mic Show after this.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
It's 7:36.
This is Pacifica Radio for the Merrimack Valley, WHAV.
This is Haverhill City Councilor Tom Sullivan. Thank you for your past support. Together, we have moved Haverhill forward, from improving our schools and our parks and recreation areas to bringing the first major downtown development in more than 30 years. My commitment to public service was inspired by my dad, former Veteran Services Director John T. Sullivan. He told me never to leave a job unfinished. I hope you agree and will vote Tuesday, November 3rd. Please make number 14 your number one choice on Election Day. Learn more at tomsullivan.us.
Wave weather!
I'm WHAV meteorologist Gary Best with Wave Weather. Generally clear for the Merrimack Valley through the night and chilly. Low temperatures down between 31 and 34. During the day on Tuesday, mostly sunny skies and back up to 55, increasing high clouds during the afternoon. Becoming cloudy at night, 38 to 42. Chance of rain developing on Wednesday, high temperature in the 50s. This is Gary Best. Your next Wave Weather is coming up in 30 minutes.
A profile of Haverhill School Committeeman Sean Toohey. Sean Toohey's been proud to represent the voices of Haverhill taxpayers for 12 years on the Haverhill School Committee. As a taxpayer with two children in public schools, Sean Toohey knows firsthand that children must have the right teachers and the best learning tools. He's achieved these goals even while keeping an eye on spending. Sean Toohey will never stop fighting for responsibility and accountability. He's fourth on the school committee ballot November 3rd.
WHAV Open Mic!
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
The last hour of the Open Mic Show, in case I forgot to say, and I don't know if I did or not, so to cover myself, the last hour of the Open Mic was brought to you by Haverhill Bank, just one bank. And this hour is brought to you by the Merrimack Valley Economic Development Council. Smart companies choose the Merrimack Valley. And as I like to say once in a while, almost every Tuesday, and if there's ever a delay or holiday, maybe Wednesday, but almost every Tuesday, go to merrimackvalley.info, merrimackvalley.info, and you can read Merrimack Valley happenings produced by the Economic Development Council. And this is the most comprehensive guide to just about anything to do between Lowell to Newburyport. Lowell, Lawrence, Haverhill, Methuen, Newburyport, Amesbury, so many free things and so on. And, you know, I've heard over the years many times by people saying, why isn't there one group coordinating all of these events? Well, there is. It's the Merrimack Valley Economic Development Council. Go to merrimackvalley.info for more information. All right. Before we take our next caller, Brian, who was on the show earlier, is absolutely right. He called to say, no, the government meetings are on Channel 9, not Channel 22. I apologize. I think the repeats may be on 22. So Haverhill City Council tomorrow night, 7 p.m. on Channel 9 on Comcast in Haverhill. That's the government channel, in case you want to learn more about this so-called energy aggregation plan. And if anyone listening has identified anything I've misunderstood, feel free to call. But meanwhile, let's go to the phones. You are on the open mic show. Are you there? You're on the open mic. Well, my red light is on, but there's no caller there. All right. I'm going to drop that. I'm sorry. I think that was Woody, right? So, Woody, somehow we lost you twice. You went into voicemail the first time, and now somehow we lost you on this end. So feel free to call back, 978-374-1900. Okay. Well, somehow we've lost a bunch of phone calls. We're Chris. So Chris is our producer. I'll blame him. But anyway, so I'm just looking at my my email messages to see if any of you have commented on anything. Those of you who would like to, you can, if you're shy, just email me at tcoco at whav.net. You can also use the message board below the TV screen at whav.tv. All right. One of the things I wanted to point out, just in case you're tuning in late or wondering about the status, it's open lines tonight, but I'm inviting a couple topics in particular. All right, we've had both Haverhill and Methuen had issues with students with weapons or threatening to use weapons. Maybe you have a thought on, is something gone wrong in our society or what? I'd like to hear your thoughts. But meanwhile, let's go to the phones. You are on the open mic show.
Hello. Is this Tim?
Yes.
This is Jerry, Tim.
Oh, hi, Jerry. So, okay.
Oh, see, I really feel badly for the... the boys that, you know, did what they did with the statements that they made. And it's sad, really. Not only it's gonna be an impact for life, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, Jerry, I don't know if you heard my question earlier. What do you think?
Yes, I did.
Are kids worse than they were, or has society changed? What's your observation?
Well, I think it's, you said something very important, financial. You got people, parents that are, you know, two parents, poor guidance at home because for a number of reasons. Hey, one reason is that they both have to work and they're not in the home. That's a tough situation for a, you know, a growing boy, or for that matter. Then what about the media? All you do is turn on, you know, stories, about, you know, killing, and you name it, really, you know?
Yeah, that's actually a good point. There are some radio show hosts like Tom Hartman, who's on WHAV in the afternoon from noon to 3. Tom Hartman has a kind of adopted a policy for his show, and it doesn't really matter here because these are juveniles and we're not going to use their names anyway, but he is not going to use the names of these shooters we hear about, because that's what they want. They want the attention.
Copycat.
And so he's not going to do that. But you mentioned copycat. Now, yeah, is that what's happening here, that it seems cool? Are we watching too many video games with violence and it seems like fun instead of dangerous?
I think so. I really think so. And, you know, I don't even go to the movies. Like, everybody was clamoring to go to the movie about Whitey.
Oh, the Whitey Bulger movie, that's right.
Yeah, I wouldn't go. I wouldn't go.
No, I mean, he murdered how many? I mean, it's more than a dozen, right?
Yeah, but...
No, you're absolutely right. So, you know, I think I saw this on a bumper sticker, and if I didn't, I just invented it. But teach empathy. And if listeners aren't sure what I mean, if you can put yourself in someone else's shoes, maybe there'd be less violence. People would say, well, my goodness, I wouldn't want to be hurt like that. I wouldn't want to leave my family without support, so I'm not going to hurt this other person. I don't know. Is teaching empathy too simple an answer? Is it making sure that one parent stays at home? Is that too simple an answer?
Yeah.
I wonder.
But it can't be, though. It can't. In many families, they, as I say, both parents have to work to put food on the table, pay the taxes. The economy isn't that great. I don't think it is.
No, so I think maybe you're right. Maybe my first guess is that we need a top-to-bottom change in how America is operating. Because 30 years ago, more than that, my father could pay for everything on simply his salary alone. We had two cars, a private home. My mother didn't have to work. And
the same thing in my family.
Now, of course, back then, television was free. We didn't have
and
cable.
You know what? Another thing, we used to play cowboys and Indians and cops and robbers with little facsimiles of guns, correct?
That's right. And we turned out okay, I guess.
And going with no thought of ever doing, you know, what some youngsters are doing. And I really feel badly. As I said, I know families that have had problems with their siblings, and they've been working hard for years, you know, trying to straighten things out. Sometimes it's fruitless. You can't.
No, you're right. Jerry, I'm afraid we're kind of backed up with calls, and I have to take a break.
Yeah.
But I appreciate your comments. Any birthday cake entries you want to make?
It's my mother's birthday, but she can't be here. She was born on Halloween. What do you think of that?
Halloween, okay.
Yeah, she was a Halloween.
So that was an October birthday.
Halloween birthday. So I'm not putting her name into the hat tonight.
All right. Well, that was nice of you to think of your mother.
But she's looking down. She's looking down, you know.
Well, it was nice of you to think of her. They're very nice. Thank you very much for your call. Take care. All right, so let's take a brief break. This hour, we're going to hear a movie review. I don't think it's the Whitey movie. I think we had that last week. So we'll be back with more of the Open Mic Show and your calls on these very important topics and enter a cake before 8:15. We'll be right back.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
Try listening to WHAV in your car or anywhere on your mobile phone. For fast access, visit WHAV.net.
Hello,
I'm City Councilor Colin LePage, and I'm proudly sponsoring today's open mic show. Thanks for tuning in. I'm running for re-election and respectfully ask for your vote on November 3rd. In 2010, I was instrumental in launching a single-stream recycling program. In 2013, I worked hard to lower your tax bill and continue to do so. Recently, I found the funds to hire an additional middle school health teacher. These are just a few examples of my dedication and commitment to Haverhill. For more information, click my banner at whav.net. Thank you.
This is Take Two Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. This week, the drug war indeed. The words drug and war together first sprang forth from the lips of Richard Nixon, who wanted to bring the symbolism of war to his political rhetoric on the issue of drugs. If you still think the term is symbolic, well, you won't after seeing director Denis Villeneuve's latest film, Sicario. The term essentially means hitman in Spanish, but early on we learn that in antiquity, the Latin term referred to agents in the Judean province who sought out and dealt with Roman agents. If you understand this, you'll know you're not in for just another shoot-'em-up. The movie is essentially a triple character study. FBI agent Kate Macer, played powerfully by Emily Blunt, is naive but becoming hard and fast after encountering the scene of a grisly drug-related mass murder. She's recruited into an elite squad which claims to be making a real difference where standard enforcement has failed. Heading up this squad is Matt Graver, a gritty Josh Brolin, with his shadowy consultant Alejandro, played chillingly by Benicio del Toro. It quickly becomes clear that Matt is no policeman, but is enfranchised at the national security level. Similarly, Alejandro is no Beltway consultant, but a former Colombian prosecutor whose wife and daughter were murdered horrifically by the Medellin cartel years before. The trio, with lots of high-grade weaponry and surveillance gear, are seeking cartel kingpin Manuel Diaz. The fact that they do find him is not a spoiler. What's important here is what's revealed about the characters and the government for whom they work. Every scene and frame in Villeneuve's Sicario captures the hopeless urban desert desolation that is the stage for the moral affront that we all know as the very real drug war. This has been Take Two Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. Catch up with us at TakeTwoMovieReview.com and feed us back on the Take Two Movie Review page on YouTube.
Here is City Council candidate Joseph J. Bevilacqua.
Hello, friends. This is Joe Bevilacqua, and I respectfully ask for one of your votes for Haverhill City Council. As you know, I have the experience, education, ability, and vision to get things done for you and your family and our city of Haverhill. Don't forget, Election Day, vote Joe Bevilacqua, Haverhill City Council, and have a great day.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
Some lively discussions tonight on the Open Mic Show. Thank you very much, folks, for participating. This hour of Open Mic being brought to you by the Merrimack Valley Economic Development Council. Smart companies choose the Merrimack Valley. Let's go to the phones. You are on the Open Mic Show.
You got me?
Yes, I think we do, finally.
Wow, how are you?
I don't know. We sent you to the wrong extension.
Well,
we hung
well,
up
that
on...
that was the full moon. Maybe it's got something to do with the ghost over at Kimball Tavern.
Yeah, maybe.
But anyway, good to hear Jerry. It's always good to hear him. It's funny, we had a friend, Mr. G. He was the voice of experience. His birthday was Halloween, too.
Oh, really? I kind of remember Mr. G on the old open mic show.
That's right, Mr. Gibault. Robert Gibault was born up on Sweet Hill Road.
He ran for city council, right?
That's right.
Okay.
Anyhow, I'd like to wish... my neighbors, I'm going to give you their first names, and I gave Chris their last name. They're both having a birthday. One's the 4th and one's the 18th, Gene and George.
Gene and George, birthdays. So there you go. Happy birthdays.
I know the ages, but I don't want to, you know, they're getting, you know.
No, that's optional. Everybody everybody's 18, right?
Well, one's 39, the other's, I think, 45, but anyway.
Okay, Jack Benny would be proud.
That's right, but I got a trivia. We got one from, I'd like to say hi to my cousin Craig. Well, my brother Craig and one of my cousins, we got a cousin here from England, Martin. Martin and Craig are probably having a few brews right now over at Kimball Tavern.
Oh, okay.
I hope they're tuned in. They're looking for the ghost.
Oh, all right. Hey, actually, I don't know if you heard me at the beginning of the program, but I said, you know, we haven't heard from Woody saying anything to his grandchildren over the air. So are they still listening in Sandown?
Yeah, but I think it's... It's only for half an hour.
That's what I thought. Selectmen.
Selectmen, yeah. I've been kind of under the weather and back to work, and a lot of things have been going on.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We got a trivia question tonight.
Okay, so did Chris take it down, or shall I take it down?
Yeah, I'm gonna ask it. He took it down. He's got the answers.
Oh, he does. Okay.
Okay.
Let's hope
so. Hopefully he does. Okay, I want you to name the three oldest houses in Haverhill.
The three oldest houses.
Excluding the John Ward House, because I know that that's supposedly the oldest house, but, you know, to me, that's...
Actually, I think David Godswood, I may be wrong, would argue that that house is a lot newer than people think.
Well, you know what? To me, it's not even... It's a house, I mean, the three I've got in mind are big. They're big structures.
Okay.
The John Ward House is kind of like a shimmy shack.
Right. Okay.
So these are well-structured houses.
All right.
And part of the question is, you've got to give me the dates. You can give me the dates. They're pretty close.
All right. So you got to name the location. Is that it?
Well, you name me the houses. Which houses? They all got names to them.
Okay. And
Chris has got the answer. And one of these houses, Bradford Junior College, was formed. In one of these houses, started in one of these houses.
All right. Well, that's a pretty good clue.
That's right. And what year? You got to give me the year with the Bradford Junior College.
All right. Each of these houses, we need to know the year.
Well, you don't have to. As long as you give me the. You give me. I mean, because I'm not sure on one of them. I know two, but I know one is close. There's only a couple of years difference. There's only like 4 years difference between the three of them.
All right, so close. Chris has the years too. Okay.
Yeah, I gave him some years, but I could be wrong on one. But I'm pretty sure I talked to the man that owns the house now, and I know for a fact these are the three oldest.
And what
outside of the John Ward House?
And what would the winner receive?
$10 gift certificate from my Kimball Tavern.
$10 gift certificate, same as cash, as I say, Kimball Tavern.
There you go. So Marcel's going to do some homework.
All right. $10 gift certificate. Did the last winner cash the gift certificate? Come in?
Who was that?
Did the last winner bring his gift certificate in?
Well, I'm not sure who it was. Who was it?
That was, his first name was Joel.
Joel, I'll talk to the one of the bosses that run the show over there.
Well, you know, it's funny. I asked him. It was a bowling related question, wasn't
it? That's right. It was.
And I asked him. He actually had done all kinds of research, and I said, "Why don't you call back the show the following week and tell us what you did and how you found it?" But he actually met some people who actually I think were former owners. I mean,
well, that's pretty good though. If people are doing that, that's what we want. We want to get people involved in Haverhill, the history of Haverhill. That's what it's all about.
All right, so you're absolutely right.
That's what we're all about, Haverhill.
No, you're
right.
Now let me ask you this: Have you're around? Have you seen candidates? Have they been knocking on your door, or you see the signs?
No, I'm way out in the boondocks. They don't come up this far. But
well, that's Ayers Village area, right?
Yeah. Well, I'm on a dead end road too, and it's tough. Somebody asked me to put a sign out. I'll mention his name. He's up to Nettle School. He's running for council. Oh God, what is his name? Oh, God, he's a new guy. He'd kill me now. See that?
You mean who? A new guy running for council? What?
Yeah, he's ran before, but he's never got in. I think that he's got a chance.
All right.
Oh, God. I'll see him. And
Fred Simmons?
Fred Simmons. There you go. Right on the tip of my tongue.
Well, you gave me enough clues. Okay. Yeah. A new person, but who has run before, who's very aggressive this season. I've noticed that Fred is out everywhere. Yes.
That's right. He's never been in, but Quimby's been in, so I could have said he was. Kenny, but I think there's going to be some newcomers on the council this year.
Yeah, I think we're going to more than fill the seat left by Scaramaccia. And I've seen over the years, now I could be very wrong and we'll see next week, but I have noticed, and we have such a contested election, we actually knock out several councilors.
Somebody's going to get knocked out because you've got people that could, collect a lot of votes.
Well, I mean,
Bevilacqua
and Hart should get seats unless they do something stupid in the next week.
Yeah, they could.
Yeah, I guess.
Well, you never know. You don't know. There'll be some surprises. I think in both races there'll be some surprises.
Oh, you're actually, school committee is very interesting too. You're right. We have one vacancy there, and we got some heavy hitters looking at that. Gail Sullivan, who came within 51 votes of winning a seat last time.
Wow.
And Sven Amarian, a former city councilor. So, yeah, there's two.
Yeah, Scott and Tui, they got to get out there and round up some votes.
Yeah, so, yeah, you're absolutely right. I think it's going to be a very exciting election. A lot of people are saying, oh, no, turnout's going to be low because there's no opposition for mayor. I don't know. I think the council and school committee race just might be exciting enough without a mayor's race.
Well, and another thing, if Joe gets in on the council, right, then
yes.
What happens to his seat?
Oh, then, that's a good question. He says he will not keep both.
That's right. So that goes to the next top vote-getter.
Yeah, I'm actually, we haven't had a vacancy like that in some time.
I think Spin got one on the city council. Tom Sullivan did.
Yeah, Tom Sullivan did, but I don't know if the
Spin
school
left.
Committee...
Spin left and Tom got the seat.
Yeah, I don't know if school committee has the same rule. That's a good question.
Well,
that's a good question.
I'm not sure either. It should be that way.
Let's see if anyone else has an idea on
that. All right, anyway, but stay away from Kimball Tavern this Halloween because it's... I heard there's something going on up in the attic up there.
Oh, all right. Hey, I'll tell you what. Maybe it's Martians. Next Saturday, coming Saturday, WHAV will do its annual broadcast of the War of the Worlds, the Orson Welles broadcast from 1938 that panicked the nation. So maybe there are Martians in your attic.
It could be.
Or they could just be ghosts.
Maybe. I think they're both. No, I think they're ghosts.
All right.
Ghosts of the past.
All right, thank you, Woody.
All right, anyway, I just want to say goodnight to Cousin Martin, and I hope him and his wife have a safe trip back to jolly old England.
Oh, very good, very good.
Don't have any too many of those frosty pops tonight.
Oh, all right, well, we wish them a safe and happy trip. Thank you.
They happen to be the old Smiths.
Oh, okay.
The old Smith clan.
All right, thank you very much, Woody. Thank you for the trivia question, too.
All right, have a good night.
All right, have a great night. Bye. Thank you. All right, we're going to go to local news. You'll hear more about those situations with air gun in the schools and threats in Methuen as well, and a little bit more about the electricity arrangements. So we'll be back with more of the Open Mic Show after that.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
It's 8:02.
WHAV LP Haverhill. WHAV is a nonprofit community service of Public Media of New England, Incorporated.
Here's what's happening in local news. A Haverhill juvenile accused of carrying what appeared to be an air gun at J.G. Whittier Middle School Friday was ordered held without bail for a, quote, probation issue, end quote. The order from a Lawrence juvenile court judge came during the unidentified male student's arraignment Friday on two counts of carrying a dangerous weapon on school property. Bail for the charges by Haverhill Police was set at $2,500 cash bail, according to Kerry Kimball Monahan, spokesperson for Essex District Attorney Jonathan Blodgett. Friday's incident at Whittier Middle School comes in the wake of two additional students arrested in Methuen late last week for alleged threats against a second school building in that community. Quote, it appears the student had an air gun that had a similar appearance to a handgun and also had a folding knife in his backpack, said Haverhill Public Schools Superintendent James F. Scully. Quote, the incident was handled expeditiously and efficiently, end quote. According to a statement Friday, a male student at Whittier School was observed with what was believed to be a handgun. Haverhill Police, in response, removed the student from the building and placed him under arrest. The school resumed normal operation after police reported no further threat to the school following a brief period under a, quote, stay-in-place mode, end quote. Meanwhile, two male students at Tenney Middle School, Methuen, ages 14 and 13, are due to be arraigned in juvenile court Monday after their arrest by Methuen Police Friday. Each was charged with making a threat against a school or assembly, according to a statement from Methuen Police Chief Joseph Solomon. Those arrests were the result of an investigation sparked by Tenney School staff reporting a 14-year-old male student, quote, advised that student not to show up for school on Monday because he was going to, quote, shoot up the school. A second Tenney student, a 13-year-old male, had stated he would supply weapons to the other student. Methuen police conducted searches at two different residential locations where the suspects live, but, quote, turned up no further evidence, end quote. Police, however, do not believe that the juveniles had serious intent or the means to do violence at their school. Quote, Methuen is a progressive community and we take threats of school violence very seriously, Solomon said. Quote, there is simply no such thing as joking about shooting up your school. In this day and age, we have to act out of an abundance of caution, end quote. The Friday arrests in Methuen followed those of two others, including last Monday's arrest of a student accused of making a threat against Methuen High School. Another student was arrested Thursday for allegedly pulling a fire alarm. More details can be found at whav.net. A Salem man was due to appear in Haverhill District Court on motor vehicle charges, including unlicensed driving, after his arrest by police Friday stemming from a traffic stop at White's Corner. According to Haverhill Police, Daniel Rooney, 61, of Salem, was arrested at 11:39 a.m. Friday at 1 Bridge Street. He was charged with driving with a revoked license and failure to stop or yield. He was also taken into custody on an outstanding warrant, charging him with driving with a revoked license. In other police news, a New Hampshire woman is due in court after her arrest Friday night on a warrant charging her with being a fugitive from justice. Haverhill Police report Tammy Gould, 52, of Farmington, was taken into custody at 8:22 p.m. Friday on Baldwin Street. Also, a Haverhill man was arrested on a warrant charging him with failure to attend jury duty. Haverhill Police report Thomas Hale, 26, of 68 Pilling Street, Haverhill, was arrested at 8:20 a.m. Friday at 340 Broadway. He was due to be arraigned Friday in Haverhill District Court. In community notes, the Haverhill Council on Aging is hosting a weekly discussion group on terrorism in the Middle East. William J. White, a retired FBI agent and a former member of the Joint Terrorism Task Force, is guiding Monday meetings beginning November 9 at 10 a.m. at the Citizens Center, 10 Welcome Street. White is an adjunct faculty member at several area colleges. For more information or to participate, contact Kathy Bresnahan or Rita LaBella at 978-374-2390. In local high school sports, Monday's schedule for the Whittier Tech Wildcats includes football. In the afternoon, freshman football plays at Georgetown High School, while the junior varsity football team is on the road at Essex Tech. Boys varsity soccer is at Shawsheen Regional Tech, while the junior varsity team hosts Chelsea High School. Girls junior varsity and varsity volleyball travels to Notre Dame Academy, Tingsboro. For more schedule details, visit whav.net. Remember, WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free. In the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom, this is Dana Esmail.
Hi, this is City Councilor Bill Masick. As a candidate for re-election on Tuesday, November 3rd, I'd like to take a moment to thank WHAV for all of the community service it provides every day. In a way, it's the same services I try to provide as your city councilor, with my proven experience, leadership, and ability. I want to thank you for your past support and ask for your support again, so that I may continue to be your voice on the Haverhill City Council. Please remember me, I'll never forget you. William J. Masick, number 3 on November 3.
From Feature Story News in Washington, I'm Kevin McAleese. The death toll is climbing after a powerful earthquake shook Afghanistan and Pakistan, along with parts of India, with over 100 people now reported dead. The magnitude 7.5 quake was centred in northeastern Afghanistan. Sudarsan Rajavan, an Afghanistan bureau chief for the Washington Post, said the earthquake triggered a deadly stampede at an Afghan school.
The earthquake struck. Scores of schoolgirls basically running out of shaking buildings at their school, and 12 of them essentially got trampled over by the rush to leave the buildings. That's where the biggest sort of single casualties we've seen so far has happened, but extremely tragic. They're all pretty young schoolgirls.
Wave weather.
I'm WHAV meteorologist Gary Best with Wave Weather. Generally clear for the Merrimack Valley through the night and chilly. Low temperatures down between 31 and 34. During the day on Tuesday, mostly sunny skies and back up to 55, increasing high clouds during the afternoon. Becoming cloudy at night, 38 to 42. Chance of rain developing on Wednesday, high temperature in the 50s. This is Gary Best. Your next Wave Weather is coming up in 30 minutes.
For more in-depth coverage of the news, visit WHAV's website at WHAV.net. Stay informed each day with local news, coupled with FSN's worldwide coverage. WHAV LP Haverhill, the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free.
Catch the wave, WHAV.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
And welcome back to the Open Mic Show, a 50-year staple of democracy in the Merrimack Valley. This hour of the Open Mic being brought to you by the Merrimack Valley Economic Development Council. Smart companies choose the Merrimack Valley. Okay, about 5 minutes, maybe four, we're going to be announcing the winner of the November LBD Second Generation Italian Bakery Cake Contest. So you have 4 minutes to call in 978-374-1900. Wish someone a happy birthday or a couple a happy anniversary, and your name will be added to the drawing, which we'll do in just a couple of minutes. We were talking, and David Gounsewood very well picked up on my cue about the John Ward House. As you know, there's a contest now from our good friends at Kimball Tavern Antiques, where if you can name the three oldest houses in Haverhill and approximately the years they went up, then you could win a $10 gift certificate to Kimball Tavern. But Woody made it clear, do not include the John Ward House. And David Gounsewood maybe tells us why in his comment at WHAV.TV. John Ward House is not as old as believed. The eastern half dates only to 1720, the western half to 1800. The building stands on its original site from which it had been removed in 1882 and then returned in 1906 when acquired by the museum. Well, I didn't know that. Very interesting history. So the John Ward House is back where it started, but it wasn't there for a few years. It's half of it was built in 1720. It's pretty small, so it must have been a small half. 1720, the western half, 1800. It's back on its original site. So David Godswood helps give us a reason why that house might not be eligible. Now, you might say, well, 1800, wow, that's very old. Well, Haverhill goes back to 1640, so maybe not. And also, David Godswood had a comment, again, at WHAV.TV on the situation we were discussing about schools. And he wrote, a pellet gun and a pocket knife can get you dragged out of school in handcuffs. That's a question, actually. A pellet gun and pocket knife can get you dragged out of school in handcuffs. Might be interesting to find out the ethnicity of this kid. So David Godswood is suggesting that some races could do that. I'm not sure I agree necessarily. I think we've kind of developed this so-called zero tolerance, but it's food for thought. Was this student who was handcuffed racially profiled? I think that's what David Godswood is asking. All right, maybe you have a thought on that. 978-374-1900. Well, Woody so far is really the only one that's taken me up on the election question. Looks like very interesting city council and school committee races. I wonder what the turnout will be. It's historically low, even in the best of times. Haverhill people half of them register, but half of the half don't even bother to come out. More than half don't turn out. I wonder why that is. Maybe you have a thought. But Brian had a comment on this issue. It was really a question. He said, are any candidates providing rides to the polls? Now, I know all of them are listening. So, Brian, I worry that this means this tradition of providing rides to the polls may have gone away. So, listen, candidates, here's your chance. Give us a call on the open mic if you are providing rides to the polls. There's at least one resident, Brian, who's hoping you are, because he may not be able to vote, and there may be many others like him. So if anyone, even if it's not the candidate, knows if there are rides to the polls, call us 978-374-1900. Okay, the cake contest is closed. We're going to take a break for Community Spotlight. When we come back, the winner of the November Albi D's Second Generation Italian Bakery Cake Contest will be announced.
Open mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
WHAV is the only FM station assigned to the city of Haverhill. The sooner you contribute at WHAV.net, the sooner WHAV signs on at 97.9 FM. Just look for the photograph of Tom Bergeron, honorary chairperson of WHAV's Make Waves campaign.
A profile of Haverhill School Committeeman Sean Toohey. Sean Toohey's been proud to represent the voices of Haverhill taxpayers for 12 years on the Haverhill School Committee. As a taxpayer with two children in public schools, Sean Toohey knows firsthand that children must have the right teachers and the best learning tools. He's achieved these goals even while keeping an eye on spending. Sean Toohey will never stop fighting for responsibility and accountability. He's fourth on the school committee ballot November 3rd.
Community Spotlight!
The Haverhill Council on Aging is hosting its annual craft fair, Saturday, November 14th at the Citizens Center, 10 Welcome Street, from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. There is no cost for the table space, and the fair is open to all crafters 60 and over. All items must be handmade, and no flea market tables are permitted. For more information, contact Kathy Bresnahan or Rita LaBella at 978-374-2390. Someone you know is on WHAV. To submit or read your own nonprofit announcements, click on the contact tab at whav.net or email news@whav.net. In the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, this is Maddie Caron.
WHAV Open Mic.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
This hour of Open Mic being brought to you by the Merrimack Valley Economic Development Council. Smart companies choose the Merrimack Valley. Okay, it's time to announce the winner of the Albedee's Second Generation Italian Bakery Cake Contest. I've already shuffled these, but I'll shuffle them again. And quite a few, but a third of them came just tonight, right? All right, so let's draw a name. Okay, here's one. All right. Chris has folded this very tightly. Okay, Christine of Salem, New Hampshire has won the November birthday cake contest. We probably should put on this form the birthday. I usually ask, but we never write it down. So, Christine, happy birthday in November. I don't know, maybe we're not supposed to know how old you are. So, very good. Congratulations. You have won a 7-inch cake from LBD, Second Generation Italian Bakery, 140 South Main Street in Bradford. Those of you who didn't win, well, you can still go there. They're open every morning at 6 a.m. I mean, really early. And as Nate Webster said in his comment at WHAV.TV earlier, you can also get all kinds of great cookies there and mini pastries and breads and pizza and pies. Desserts and sweetbreads, specialty cakes, my goodness, lions and tigers and bears, oh my, it's what it seems like there. So quite a bit there. All right, we have a few minutes left if anyone wants to call in. Really welcoming your call on this issue. Is David Goudswood right? Is this an overreaction? Student bringing in an air gun or a pocket knife, which he had in his backpack. Let's be fair. It wasn't like he was wielding it at somebody. But is David Goudswood right? You know, would that have happened 30 years ago? Brian and I just said no. 30 years ago, we might actually have been using our pocket knives in school. Knives in school. Brian said there was one time a teacher was opening a package and asked students if anyone had a knife. So certainly times have changed. Maybe you don't want to comment on that aspect. Maybe you want to comment on Jerry said tonight that he agrees with me that maybe it's an economic issue. You've got both parents out of the home, kids on their own. And maybe a third item, they're all watching violent movies and playing violent video games. And it's funny, during the movie review last hour, I guess I spoke too soon. It was about a violent movie. So maybe it's just a big societal problem. I'd like to hear your thoughts on that. 978-374-1900. And then we had a news item on the national news that bacon and ham might be cancerous, and other red meats may be cancerous too. Any of you switching to vegetarianism now? I wonder. Call if you want to talk about that. And let's do a rundown of the city council and school committee races. Oh, and by the way, I should point out that WHAV will rebroadcast once or maybe twice the full three-hour forum sponsored by the League of Women Voters of Greater Haverhill. So you'll be able to hear from all six school committee candidates and 13 of the 15 city council candidates from that forum. We'll rebroadcast that. Look at WHAV.net for the schedule. We'll announce it on one of the top news items. And so probably going to be later this week and over the weekend, and then, or maybe even as late as Monday night after this show, so your last minute before you cast your votes. All right, on the city council ballot, this is how you're going to see it. Former city councilor Dave Hall is going to be the top of the ballot. They did a drawing in city council chambers, and it's just a raffle, and he drew the first name, he drew the first number, number one. And after that, we have Councilor Michael McGonigal, Councilors William Masick, Melinda Barrett, and William Ryan, School Committee Man Joseph Bevilacqua, who is seeking a council seat, former Councilor Michael Hart, Councilor Colin LePage, and contenders Fred A. Simmons, Andy Vargas, Katrina Hobbs Everett, Councilor Mary Ellen Daly O'Brien, Council President John Mitchetson, Councilor Thomas Sullivan, and former Councilor Ken Quimby. All right. Coming in last on the ballot worries some folks, like I would imagine Kenny is a little concerned, because sometimes people see a name and they'll check it off. Oh, I recognize that. Check, check, check. And they get to nine and say, oh, I'm out of votes. But there are people after that, oh my goodness, I should have voted for so-and-so. And, well, I already voted for nine. What can I do? Well, you can ask for another ballot. I believe that is allowed. You can ask for another ballot if you've done that, so that you can say, oops, I made a mistake. Can I have another ballot? So, you know, that is a solution for some of you who may make that mistake. You can get another ballot. But, you know, some counselors are saying, well, start at the bottom and work your way up. Those are the people who are on the bottom of the ballot. I will say that it may very well be a disadvantage to some incumbent city councilors being that low on the ballot. So this is going to be an exciting race. On the school committee side, what do we have here? Pam Conte. Pam Conte, well-known Haverhill name, is true the first place. And what else do we have here? Following Conte on the school committee ballot are Gail Sullivan, who, again, I mentioned, came in within 51 votes last time. Incumbent school committee man Scott Wood, who's the school committee president this year. And Sean Toohey, who's a former school committee president. And then contenders Michael Sherman and former city councilor Sven Amerian. Now, with only six on the school committee race, maybe it's less likely that people will not look far enough down the list. So maybe last place for Sven Amerian is not a problem. It's certainly a well-recognized name from city council. What some people think may be going against him is that he left his second city council term 6 months in to become president of the Greater Haverhill Chamber of Commerce. Remains to be seen whether people will think, well, he did what he needed to do for the city and there'd be no issues there, or maybe some will wonder about that. But everybody has an issue. Everybody has a friend. Everybody has an enemy. Maybe you have a thought on that. Just a programming note. This Saturday will be the anniversary. Actually, Friday is actually the anniversary of the famous War of the Worlds broadcast. The Mercury Theater on the Air with Orson Welles announced a Martian invasion of the Earth, causing, apparently, you know, some people disagree that it caused the panic, but many newspapers reported a great panic. Well, we're not going to do it on Friday. We're going to run it on Saturday, Halloween itself, the War of the Worlds with Orson Welles. And this is a simulated newscast that were done in 1938 that had some people thinking Martians had invaded the Earth. If you want a real treat of old-time radio, listen at 10 p.m. Saturday, October 31st, WHAV.net. Again, Saturday, 10 p.m. There'll be a repeat at 1 a.m. So that's Sunday at 1, Saturday night at 10, Sunday morning at 1 a.m., The War of the Worlds with Orson Welles and the Mercury Theater on the air. All right, so those were some of our big topics. Let's get you ready for next week. I think we've already received one call, making sure that they understood the question. So next week we'll start the December. That's kind of scary. The December birthdays and anniversaries in the Albi D's second generation Italian bakery cake contest. But we'll also have. You could win a $10 gift certificate, same as cash, to Kimball Tavern Antiques, corner of Salem and South Main Streets in Bradford. All you have to do to win that is be the first to answer these questions. Name the three oldest houses. I guess they all have names. Name the three oldest houses in Haverhill. Do not include, this is kind of a clue, a helpful hint, do not include the John Ward House, whose history is disputed. These are all big houses, we're told, and they all have names. So name the three oldest houses, but also, as close as you can, there's some wiggle room here, the year that they were built. So three oldest houses in Haverhill and the year they were built. All right, looks like Haverhill Community Television has broken away. We observed at the beginning of the program their clock was off, and we had kind of worked out our clock with the atomic clock. So I think ours is good, but we'll go. And happy birthday, Christine. We'll be back next week with Election Eve coverage on the Open Mic Show. Have a great night.
Open Mic!
Join Tim Coco live on the Open Mic again next Monday night at 6:30. The opinions expressed on the Open Mic Show are not necessarily those of WHAV, its underwriters, or affiliated stations. The Open Mic Show came to you from the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom.